Whatever the persecutors are, you are standing firm with the Lord. And then you are holding fast the profession of your faith without wavering. For he is faithful that promise. He will see you through. I said he will see you through. This our God is the omnipresent God. He feels both the earth and the heaven. He's the omniscient God. That means he knows all things. He's the omnipotent God. He can do all things. He's the possessor of the heavens and the earth. He's of unspotted perfect purity. He's the infinite God that is infinite in love, infinite in wisdom, infinite in power. And he's good and merciful. His mercy will never leave your life in Jesus' name. Point number two now, Daniel chapter 6. Daniel chapter 6. We're looking at verse 26. Daniel chapter 6, verse 26. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. Look up, brothers and sisters, for a moment. I make a decree. You know, it's wonderful when you see you've done something wrong to be able to reverse that thing. You know, there are people, if they do something wrong, if they're going the wrong direction, and then there comes a discovery, and the light shines in your heart. Oh, they say, I'm going to hold on to my integrity. I'm going to hold on to my self-esteem. I'm going to hold on to my personality. If I turn around, if I change, people will think I'm not a stable fellow. What am I saying? Darius made a decree before, and he signed that decree. If anybody will pray to any God anywhere, except unto him, Darius, for all these 30 days, he'll be thrown into a lion's den. And now that thing had happened, that Daniel prayed, he threw him to the lion's den, and then Daniel came out without being hurt. And then Darius said, I was wrong. All these presidents and princes and persecutors, they deceived me. I have been deceived in making that decree. Now I'm going to correct what is wrong in your life. That's what makes you a great man. That's what makes you a great woman. That's what makes you a real believer. That's what makes heaven to smile upon you. When you know I've done something wrong, I signed a wrong decree. The direction I was going, that was wrong. Now I reverse everything. And you see what he has done here. Reverse the decree that he made before. He said, throw that one away. Although they said, it's by the law of the Medes and the Persians that altereth not, that changes not. He said, this miracle has changed the law of the Persians and of the Medes. And this miracle that I see has altered everything I ever signed. I cancel that one. I throw that one away. I wipe that one out. If you will do that in your life, God's blessing will come upon you. And God will write about you in his book, in the book of remembrance. That's why Darius' name is over here. And the decree, the new decree, that's why it's over here. Because he reversed the original decree. You look at your life. What things have you said? There are some people that say, once I determine, this is what I will do, I will do it. Even if I discover later I was wrong, I will still do what I said I will do. Once I have signed something, and once I've committed myself, I want to be a man of my word. And even if I see that I was wrong, I'm going to still keep to it because I'm a man of my word, not Darius. Darius said, I was wrong. That's what a decree I can say. What's it in your life that you now discover as we study the word of God? What promise have you made? You now discover you are wrong. And what thing have you signed? You now discover you are wrong. And what kind of decision have you taken before? And now you see that you are wrong. You will reverse it tonight. And that's why Darius, that's what he did. He said, I reverse that thing. I make a new decree. This new decree supersedes the other decree. This new decree cancels the other decree. Forget about that one. I was deceived into that. This is the decree now. We're going to walk by. And as you walk by this new decree, the blessing of God will be abundant in your life in Jesus' name. That's repentance. That's restitution. That's turning around. That's saying, I was wrong. I will not do that again. I will not say that again. I will not sign something like that again. I'm going to now stand by a new word, a new promise, a new decision, a new decree. And that's the reason we come to study the Bible, so that as we're studying the Bible and the word of God reveals something to you that you are wrong in showing to you. You are wrong in something you said. You are wrong in something you did. You are wrong in an action that you took. You say, Lord, now I realize I'm going to change. I'm going to turn around. Everything will be new from today in Jesus' name. Come back to Daniel chapter 6 and verse 26. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, steadfast forever. And his kingdom, that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He's telling us about the authority of this living God. It is common knowledge that the great kingdoms of the past have been destroyed. When Nebuchadnezzar and Darius received revelations of from heaven, they became enlightened and they are waking to the spiritual realities and divine truth. They both affirmed that the only living God, the eternal God, will have, only the living God, only the eternal God will have a kingdom, a dominion, which shall not be destroyed. That's what is said here, and that was what the dream of Nebuchadnezzar revealed. Let's look at Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. God shall set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and shall stand forever. The kingdom of God will stand forever. That's what Nebuchadnezzar eventually realized. Let's look at Daniel chapter 4, verse 34. Daniel chapter 4, verse 34. And at the end of the days, I, Daniel, lifted up mine eyes unto heaven, and mine understanding returned unto me. And I blessed the Most High, and I praised and honored him that liveth how long? Forever. Whose dominion is what kind of dominion? An everlasting dominion. And his kingdom is from generation to generation. When the light came, when the knowledge came, when enlightenment came into them, then they knew that this God is an everlasting God. And his kingdom, his dominion, is from generation to generation. It will not be left to another. It will not be destroyed. Was that peculiar to Nebuchadnezzar? Was that peculiar to Darius? Did other people know that this God has a dominion that will be forever and ever? Let's see in the word of God in Exodus chapter 15. Exodus chapter 15, we're looking at verse 18. Exodus 15, verse 18. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. A good amen. It will reign in your heart. It will reign in your life. It will reign in your business. It will reign in your family. And it will reign forever and ever. You know the implication of that? The moment you commit your life to the Lord, you never look back again. You say, I've given my life to the Lord, and on, forever and ever. It will reign in my life here. And then when you cross over from earth to heaven, the Lord is still reigning. It means that you'll never give the throne of your heart to any other God anymore, to any other supreme being anymore, and to any other master, any other Lord anymore. You say, Jesus is my Lord. He has become my Savior, and I've given the control of my life unto him. And this God, the King of heaven and earth, he is my King now. He is my Lord now. He is my director, my leader, my master, my controller. And because of that, he shall reign in my heart, in my life, forever and ever. I pray it will be so. In Psalm 93, we're looking at verse 1. Psalm 93, verse 1. The Lord reigneth, he is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he has girded himself. The world also is established, that it cannot be moved. He tells us it's because the Lord is reigning, because the Lord is in control. That's why the world is established. And if the Lord is in control of your life will be established. Nothing you build and nothing you develop, nothing you plan will ever be destroyed in Jesus' name. And you know, there are people, they say, I don't understand. And they go about, they go here and there, and they say, I don't know whether a curse is following after me. If I try to develop this, and just at the time it's going to be established, everything will crumble again. And then I start another thing, and just at the time I'm going to be established, everything will crumble again. What's the solution to that? The solution to that is to invite the Almighty God, the living God, the God of the heavens and the earth, and the one that controls the whole universe, and he makes the world to be established, is to invite him to your heart and life, and to say, Lord, I've tried my best, I've tried everything I could, and every time I want to get it established, it's been demolished. I now give it into your hand, because I know anything that is surrendered into the hand of the Lord is going to be established. And then when you allow the Lord to take control and to rule and to reign forever and ever, you will never be disappointed in Jesus' name. We're looking at Psalm 45, and we're reading from verse 6. Psalm 45, verse 6. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. That means then, the throne of God, we're talking about his throne in heaven, and also he has throne here on earth, and then in your heart, he has a throne. You say, Lord, reign, Master Jesus, in my heart, in my life, in my family, reign, Master Jesus. Say, there's a throne in my heart for the Lord, and I'm not going to have another Lord, another God, another being, another master, another controller over there on my heart forever and ever. Jesus will reign in your life in Jesus' name. And we're looking at Psalm 145. I'm reading from verse 11. In Psalm 145 verse 11, here is what it says. They shall speak of the glory of thy kingdom and talk of thy power, to make known to the sons of men his mighty acts and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. Thy kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and thy dominion endureth throughout what? All generations. Psalm 146 verse 10. 146 verse 10. The Lord shall reign forever. The Lord shall reign forever. Even thy God, O Zion, to all generations, praise ye the Lord. We're looking at Revelation chapter 11 verse 15. Revelation chapter 11. And here we're looking at verse 15. That's when the kingdoms of this world, when they eventually come to the Lord Jesus Christ, he rules without a rival. And he rules without anybody that can say, what are you doing there? Revelation chapter 11 verse 15. And the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign for how long? Forever and ever. The reign of the eternal God, the everlasting King, extends over all people. In all the nations, from generation to generation, God's authority and dominion are unlimited and unrestricted. His sovereignty is unconfined, and his power is irresistible. The scriptures are full of the revelation of God's everlasting dominion. God's dominion is not only in the world, but also it's in heaven. It is not only in time, it's also in eternity. The duration of his reign extends through all eternity. God's dominion over men, over angels, will be forever and ever. All men, even Pharaoh or Saul or Nebuchadnezzar or Darius or Alexander the Great or Herod or Caesar or Nero, anyone that has anything, all of them, they came to an end, and their kingdoms and dominions always came to an end. They all came to an end. We shall continue to see the end of man's reign, but the time is not long enough to put God's reign to an end. The eternal God shall reign forever and ever. The government of the everlasting eternal King shall be forever. All his creatures, all men, all angels shall be ruled by his will, by his word, by his laws. As the Almighty God, he is qualified in every way to govern and to rule over all men, over all things, over all angels, forever and ever. Dominion is his, and he has supreme power to exercise over all. By his omnipotence, he has established and sustained the earth and the heavens with all the inhabitants therein. By his infinite power, his infinite wisdom, will he reign over all forever and ever. He is clothed with majesty. The robe of his royalty will be ever glorious, and his kingdom and dominion, his majesty and glory, his wisdom and strength will be shown in eternal splendor in the sight of saints and angels forever and ever. And the people of God said, now we're going to look at the acts of this living God. We have seen the attributes of the living God, and we have seen the authority of the living God. Now we want to see his action, what he does, and what he did at that time, and what he's still doing today. We're looking at Daniel chapter 6, and we're reading from verse 27. Daniel chapter 6, verse 27. Let's see the act of the living God. In Daniel chapter 6, verse 27, he delivereth and rescueth, and he worketh signs and wonders in heaven and in earth, who has delivered Daniel from the power of lions. As you look at this verse, you rest and say, praise the Lord, this same God is my God, and our God is not a partial God. Our God is not a respecter of persons. If he saved, if he delivered, if he protected, if he rescued the believers of the past generation, all the believers you included in this generation, he will rescue you. He will deliver you. He will protect you. If you will rest and relax in the Lord, like Daniel did, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did, like Elijah and Elisha did, like Moses and Joshua did, like all those people of God did in the past, if you will rest in the Lord and believe in the Lord, no problem will crush you in Jesus' name. And no lion will be able to destroy you in Jesus' name. You can rest assured that the faithful God, he'll be faithful to his word, he'll be faithful to his promise, and when you pray, the Lord will answer that prayer. We're looking at the acts of the living God. We're looking at Psalm 97, verse 10. Not Psalm 97, we're looking at verse 10, still giving us the assurance that this God is a mighty God, and because of the love we have towards him, he's going to deliver, going to protect us in Jesus.